Hello, thank you for joining us. My name is Diane Ford, and this is Deep Roots. Today, I am here with Katherine Tena, who is a student at the Bethel Park High School, and she is extremely creative, and she has written a poem called Acting White. We're going to talk today about what that means, where that came from, and the wonderful things that she's doing within our community to make a difference. Hi, Katherine. Thanks
Hello.
For joining us.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So, Katherine, tell me a bit about yourself.
Well, like you said, I'm a student at Bethel Park High School, and I have two brothers, so I'm the only girl. but I really enjoy like writing and painting and just being creative, I guess. Mm-hmm. But I also do some sports like lacrosse. And then, of course, I enjoy like speaking.
Great. Well, we met a couple of months ago, and we both sat on a panel for a roundtable discussion. And you had some really great insights, and I really want to delve a little bit deeper into the poem that you wrote. Tell us about that, and what's the meaning behind that, and you know why you felt so inspired to write such a wonderful work.
Yeah, my poem was like about minorities or people of color acting white instead of and ignoring their backgrounds in history. Mm-hmm. So it was really important to me because for a lot of my life, well, in fact, up until probably third grade, I didn't even know that I wasn't white. Mm-hmm. because I felt like I fit in, and I thought if I wasn't white, then I didn't fit in. Mm-hmm. So I wrote this poem to kind of like, as a starting point to like kind of tell myself, okay, I'm Filipino and proud, mm-hmm. and I don't have to wear a Filipino flag everywhere, but I also don't have to pretend that I'm something that I'm not just to be like other people. Like I can use terms like tita, meaning aunt, rather than the English version, aunt and uncle. Mm-hmm. So it was really important to me that did get into the poem. Mm-hmm. Probably the one thing that really made me start writing the poem was actually a book called Patron Saints of Nothing that I read for my honors English class over the summer. And there was one small part in the book that was just the main character is Filipino, mm-hmm. and his white friend was talking about how like he forgot that he was white, or he forgot that he was Filipino, mm-hmm. Because he just acts so white. And so that's what kind of like pushed that off into the poem. Mm-hmm.
The aha moment.
Yeah.
So you began to realize that some of the things that you were doing in your day to day was not celebrating all of who you are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like I would feel less comfortable wearing certain, like, I have earrings and a necklace from the Philippines, and I would feel like, oh, maybe it's just too, I would tell myself that it was just too fancy or something mm-hmm. like that, but in the back of my mind, it was kind of like, it's not normal, quote unquote. Mm-hmm.
Subconsciously.
Yeah.
So, just reading the book and starting to write out how you're feeling and what you're going through, that inspired you to write the poem.
Thank you.
with the realization that you're different and accepting that, how have you gone about your daily life post-poem?
Well, I've been more open, like, to my friends about it and to mm-hmm. other people. And, of course, my friends knew that I wasn't white, but I found out that some of them thought that I was Hispanic instead of Filipino. Mm-hmm. And that did bug me a little bit, because even though the Philippines do have a history with the with Hispanic people, I'm not Hispanic. I'm mm-hmm. my culture is different. Mm-hmm. So I, over like a couple, like a month or two, I would have talks with my friends, just like, this is my culture, mm-hmm. and this is what how I do things. And we may eat different things than you. We may we celebrate different things from you. We have different art, mm-hmm. but we're still, you know, I still want to be your friend, and we're still people. And it's mm-hmm. it's another thing that makes me different instead of mm-hmm. fitting in.
So one of the things that I always like to stress is being unique and appreciating your differences. And so has your friendships changed as a result of you sharing your newfound appreciation for your own ethnicity?
No, I'm really fortunate that my friends are very, they don't know a lot about my culture mm-hmm. and my history, but they respect it, and that really feels good mm-hmm. when yeah. someone accepts who you are and through and accepts like your race.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, well, I'm a strong believer there's only one race, right? The human race. And so, so your ethnic background is what they will accept.
Yeah.
Your difference, the value that you bring, the culture that you can introduce people to. I also believe that the better we know each other, the more we communicate, the more none of the external matters. It matters what we have in our heart and how we treat each other. And so with that said, I want to learn a little bit about your culture. So you just mentioned in the beginning of this segment about your the name that you call your aunt or your uncle or whatever. So your language is different. And what kind of foods do you eat differently that are not as, you know, we don't do here in America? What are some of your cultural foods?
I know the Philippines, and I know other Asian cultures also. We eat a more type of breakfast that people in America would have for lunch. Mm-hmm. Like I would, a lot of the times I make fried rice in the morning, mm-hmm. and my mom doesn't like to eat such a hearty breakfast. Mm-hmm. But then also there's a dish that my grandmother makes called adobo, mm-hmm. and it's basically chicken and rice. Mm-hmm. It's a chicken and rice dish, but it like takes all day to make, and it's like throughout the entire day you smell it in the house.
And I just imagine.
Yeah, I love it uh-huh. so much. And then probably my favorite Filipino food would be lumpia, mm-hmm. which is meat and carrots mm-hmm. wrapped in rice paper and then fried.
Okay.
And it's like they never stay in our house more than an hour.
Okay.
Like as soon as they're out of the fryer, they're always eaten no matter how hot they are.
Lumpia. Okay, so the next time I see you, I want some lumpia.
I'll be sure to make some.
So what is it like for you and your siblings? Do you notice, do you feel like your brothers are proud of their ethnicity and their background? Or do you think they struggle a little bit?
I know that my brothers are proud of their background, and we have a lot of friends that are of different ethnicities, so it's mm-hmm. kind of easier. But I've noticed that while I'm more kind of like, whoever you are, I don't care if you know my ethnicity, mm-hmm. my older brother, my younger brother is a little like too young to notice the social kind of side of things, but my older brother, definitely it takes a while before he like talks about pretty much anything, much less like his background.
Okay, so he's more of an introvert.
Yeah.
Just naturally. So it has nothing to do with
being uncomfortable with who he is.
Okay. So I don't know, a lot of people may have heard my story before, but you know, I grew up in this area forever, and I attended the schools, and as an African American child, I did not really understand. I don't think in elementary school I really knew that I was different. I knew that I was different, but I didn't, you know. And it wasn't until I started having comments thrown at me and hearing them thrown at family members that were negative that I really understood that people were racist. I was just raised to be respectful to everybody and to, you know, I just valued, you know, people, period. So I grew up, you know, that way. Now we're in this 2020, and the unfortunate thing is that I've noticed that there's not a whole lot that changed from the time that I was a teenager up until now, or probably from the time I was born until now, but I wasn't aware of it, you know, at a younger age. What are some of the things that you're doing in the community to make a difference so that people, all people, feel valued and important?
Well, one big thing for me is like my art. I love painting, so I'll do like paintings for like my church and stuff like that. Some of the time I also write a poem that I really enjoy and has a message that I really believe in. And I'll go through looking for a bunch of contests to enter that in.
Okay. So how many contests have you entered?
Well, with my poems, I've entered like two or three this year. And then essay-wise, I entered one just like last week, and then I'm entering another in January.
Okay. So you've been writing for a while, or did you just recently start sharing your voice in that poetic way?
I recently started sharing my voice poetically, but I've always knew that I really enjoyed like public speaking and writing for people to hear, because we would have projects in middle school that had us do public speaking, and I would always notice like, I was always like, oh, I don't want to, I don't want to speak in front of the class. And I'm like, it's not a big of a deal. You just have to do it.
Yeah, I mean, actually, knowing that, I love this, that you know that you have a voice and it's worthy to be heard. That's very important. That's powerful. And so if, like, I kind of wish that I had that, you know, foresight when I was your age, then I would be like, well, I kind of did. I mean, I don't have a problem speaking to people when I'm passionate about something. So tell me, in addition to that, we've started talking a lot more lately, and we do have some ideas and thoughts for some future programming that we're working on. And one of the big things is, like you said, that you like your artwork, and so what kind of artwork are you painting, or what kind of things are you doing?
I had a personal like painting that I did. It was for my grandmother who lives down in Florida, and it was of the Filipino rice fields.
Okay.
And it was really important to me, and I spent a long time trying to get it just right, because it was like the first time that I didn't copy a paint, like I didn't take inspiration from a different painting that I've seen or a different artwork that I've seen. It's something that was very personal to me.
100% your vision.
Yeah.
That's cool. So you also participated in, you had some artwork. Did you have artwork in that I Have a Dream?
Yes.
Okay. And so knowing that your creative vision is coming to life and you're seeing the fruit of your labor and being noticed as an artist and as a poet, what do you see your future looking like?
Well, I know for sure that I'm definitely not going to stop. Mm-hmm. It's something that I want to do for as long as I can. Mm-hmm. And I think being young is also an attribute in getting my voice out, because people kind of see a young person that's speaking their mind, and I think that can be really inspirational. Mm-hmm. So I definitely want to do as much as I can for as long as I can. Mm-hmm. And I think, of course, I have a plan for my future and what I want to pursue in a career, but mm-hmm. right now I want to work with Deep Roots, and I want to work with people to make people in this community feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. Because I think that's like the most important thing.
I totally agree with that. So now, as we continue to develop Deep Roots and start diving a lot deeper into understanding our differences and valuing them and showing worth, you know, that people are worth being respected, because we can always agree to disagree. We never have to be, you know, nasty towards one another. But as we're doing this and navigating this new normal with COVID and all that stuff, it's very important when people are isolated, because a lot of people are out, like, not in their homes, that we are able to bring some life and some fun and some entertainment and some education and some, you know, random facts and information. So when we spoke pre-recording, you mentioned that you know some random you're known for the random facts and thoughts that you have. So I'm just going to put you on the spot here and ask you to share a couple of random facts that you know about whatever it is that you want to.
I know that it's like the human mind doesn't stop comprehending things as soon as you're heart stops, actually. After someone's heart stops, the mind keeps going for 17 more seconds, which is kind of, it's kind of cool how scientists have figured that out. That's, like, amazing to me.
That's truly a random fact.
I know.
And I'm actually curious how they know that.
Yeah.
Okay, give us one more random fact.
The way that you walk can actually tell someone a lot about you. Like, if you lead with your head, it's shown that you work hard to get stuff done. You want to get stuff done as soon as possible. If you lead with your chest and, like, with your head up with good posture and just, mm-hmm. like, kind of like a power stance, you are a leader, and you, as well as getting stuff done, you want to work with people, and mm-hmm. you have a lot of confidence. And then there's also, like, nervous habits that people develop while walking. Mm-hmm. Like, certain ways that they're, if you walk on your toes, you're a little more anxious than mm-hmm. other people. So it's really cool that those kind of things are known.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for those random facts. Yeah. I'm gonna have to pay attention to the way that I stand. I know I'm a sloucher, but I do have a lot of confidence. I don't know, like, we'll see. I'll figure it out.
Yeah.
So what is it that you would like to say to any young person that questions you know, the value of who they are and appreciates who they are 100% or less than 100%. What do you have to say to?
Well, I would say no matter how young you are, you have an opinion, and so you have a voice. And whether that outlet is writing or talking to people, your opinion deserves to be heard, no matter what it is. And if you don't feel completely confident in yourself, start small. You don't have to start with entering contests. You can start with having a conversation with your family or your friends. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really what started building up my confidence to get to this level.
Yeah, that's great. So I want to thank you so much, Katherine, for sharing with us today. The next time we get together, I actually would like to see you participate and host a couple of these sessions. And also, I want to make sure that we share your artwork and your poetry. So do you have a place where the poem that you wrote is published? Or do you have a site that people can visit to look at your work or see what you've been doing?
I have one of my poems published in the fall edition of Skipping Stones magazine. Okay. I'm planning on making kind of a website that has everything kind of in one place, mm-hmm. instead of just sitting in my Google Drive.
Okay. That's fantastic. So, I would like to thank you for joining us with Deep Roots. We're going to dive deeper and deeper into a lot of things and topics. And as we're developing our programming, we want to make sure that you understand that you are valuable, that you are important, that there is nothing that is impossible for you to accomplish if you just believe in yourself. Never let anybody tell you that you can't, because you are a phenomenal person. Thank you so much for joining us, and continue to have a great day.